같이.
Them off to them.
That's alright. Well done. Oh, oops, that's okay. Pop that in the tin. That's okay. That's it. Don't worry, it's alright. There you go. Then blow that out. Pop it in. Okay, so Philippians chapter 4. Verses 4 to 6.
Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God.
Awesome. That was lovely, wasn't it? Good morning, everyone. Good morning, those of you in the room here. It's so fun to be able to open our doors again and have some people in the room. There are spaces. So if in future weeks, if you want to come along, we'd love to see you in the room. It does make a real difference having a few people here and feeling like we're doing this thing together. So do please feel free to do that. Good morning, happy Advent. I don't think I've led a service in Advent yet, so it's just lovely to be at this time of year again. First of all, because I think for all of us, this means that 2020 is indeed nearly over, and it gives us a good shot at the next year ahead. But also because it's so nice to have this kind of this anchor point in our year where there's a degree of normality. There's a degree of kind of like we can focus around this story, and this story is always here, regardless of whether the year's been great or whether the year's been rubbish. This story is still here, and it's still beautifully relevant. The good news of great joy comes into the world, and this story of God with us. God wants to incarnate with us into both the beauty and the pain and the mess in our lives. This morning, our theme, our kind of word, is joy. You may have noticed that we've been going through some kind of key words through Advent. So we've done love and we've done hope already. And this morning, we're thinking about joy. And what we really want is for this time to be a time where we can rejoice together, where we can enjoy the beautiful good news of this story breaking into our lives, the beautiful kind of hope of this season. And so we want to give you a bit of a taste of joy, I guess, together as we gather this morning. Now, Kath was originally going to be leading the service. She's now unable to be here this morning. So this is kind of me picking up on her notes a little bit. But she was going to read this really beautiful quote, which I'm going to read to you from Martin Lloyd-Jones. And then after that, we're going to have a little video. And the video is, you may have also noticed, hopefully you've noticed, that on our Facebook page, there's been a bit of an Advent calendar going on of things that are giving One Church people life and joy and peace at the moment. And we're celebrating those together as we go through Advent. If you've missed it, this video will be a great chance for you to see and catch up with that and have a taste of joy. And then after that, Dan and I will appear magically on the stage behind and we'll sing a carol together. I'm doing a lot of preamble, but when we sing that carol, this is probably a great chance for you to pelt out some carols in your own home. Now, I know that when we do this kind of singing thing through the live stream, it's a little bit odd, and it's probably even more odd in the building because you guys aren't allowed to sing however much you want to. But this is like when we get to sing carols together at this time of year. Everyone loves to sing a carol, and no one cares if you do it badly. So when we come to kind of sing in a little bit, why not just pelt it out and enjoy, go to town in your living room and have a bit of a sing. So we're going to have this quote, then we'll have the video, then we'll have a song. That's more me telling myself what's happening than telling you what's happening, and telling Sim what's happening as well at the back there. Let's just take a moment to be present to each other in our different spaces around the city, and to be present to God. And of course, to be present to ourselves, which is sometimes the hardest thing to do. This is from Martin Lloyd-Jones. Your foundations in life may be gone. Everything you built on may be crashing down, and you yourself going down into the abyss. But no, underneath, and they are always there, underneath are the everlasting arms. They are always holding you. You will never finally crash. You will be held when everything else is gone. Let's watch this video together and then we'll sing.
The sky is written with angels singing. Whoa, 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 yeah. Hosanna in excelsis.
Ding dong.
In so here below, as steeple bells be swung, and the yo 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 by priests and people sung in.
Sing joy to the world.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. And heaven and heaven and songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. He rules the world with truth and
seamless transition back to this position. This is like a great moment now for us to kind of pause and think, where in the world needs that joy? Where in the world needs that peace? Where in the world needs the hope of this story? And as we do that, the intention is that I will light these Advent candles. However, there is a slight problem, which is that I haven't got any matches. And so what I would quite like is if a runner in the room could root around. Caveman, do you know any matches might be in this room? And we will find them, and we will light these Advent candles, but it just might not be right now. So we will do that together. But for a moment, while that's kind of happening, and don't let the buzz in here interfere with you, what we're going to do is just take a moment of calm, take a moment of peace, to think about those spaces that need joy, that need peace. And then we've got a prayer that's going to come on as a video as well. So let's just take a few moments together. Maybe it's someone who's close in your orbit who really needs joy. Maybe there's a situation in your area that you know, oh gosh, I need the joy of the Lord there. Maybe it's something that's been on the news. An area, place, a situation that needs the joy and the hope of the Lord, that needs to know God with us. Thank you. Let's have this prayer.
God, we thank you for the gift of joy. Help us to share it with one another. We wait for Jesus with hope, love, and joy. Amen.
Am I back on? Oh, sorry. I'm going for this screen, and it doesn't show me, so I got confused. Should we light these candles? Now, we found some matches. I think Alex Mabs won the prize for Chief Match Finder, and you'll get to hear from Alex in a little bit. So I'm going to light these matches, and then it's another chance to sing together. We're going to sing a song called The Joy of the Lord by Wren Collective. So let's light these matches. Candles. And yes, God, thank you for this picture that is in itself a truth, that your light comes into our world. Your light breaks into the darkness. That to those living in the land of the shadow of death, your light has dawned. And so, God, we welcome your light. We acknowledge your light, and we also look for your light. And we want it to break in more and more into our lives, into the lives of those we love, and into the world. Amen. Amen. Now I'm going to hop back up onto the stage, and we're going to sing another song together called The Joy of the Lord.
Though the tears may fail, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When I cannot see you with my eyes, let faith arise to you. When I cannot feel your hand in mine, let faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, you shine with glory, Lord of light, I feel alive with you. In your presence now I come alive, I am alive with you. There is strength in my say, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Sing the joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When sorrow comes my way, you are the shield around me. You remain my courage in the fight. I hear you call my name, Jesus. I am coming, walking on the waves, reaching for your light. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to be back here. After all this time, and think about joy together. I'd like to, I'm a bit boomy. I'd like to invite you to cast your minds back. A lot of us have been thinking about how life used to be, but cast your minds back, say, 2,500 years. The people of God were in exile, far from their home. Their life had been disrupted, the life they'd known, their normal routines, everything was different. And inevitably, a lot of them thought, if only we could go back to how things were. But the city they'd lived in was in ruins. The temple was in ruins, so that whole religious aspect of their life, which had been, in theory at least, so important to them, had gone and was no longer possible. And in any case, they had changed. That time in exile for the Jewish people was incredibly fruitful as a time of reflection on their faith and on the stories that they told about themselves and about God. It's a real time of quite rapid and extensive development. So they couldn't go back. So what? What could they do? And at this time, sort of after a few decades of being in exile, the prophet we know as Isaiah, who wrote the kind of what we think is the middle chapters of Isaiah, we think the work of this prophet, between chapters 40 and 55, come from towards the end of this time of enforced exile. And in a nugget, the prophet is encouraging the people to go back, but not to go back, rather, to go forwards, but to go home, to a new home in their own land. That God is going to end their time of exile. God is going to do something new. And one of the repeated themes that Isaiah uses in this section is that as they go, they're not going to go the easy way, which was up the river Euphrates and down through the other leg of the Fertile Crescent back to Jerusalem and Judah. They were going to go across the desert, hundreds of miles of desert. And as they went, God would make the desert blossom into life, and the dry places would be filled with pools, and they would all try to burst out into rejoicing and singing and life as the people of God were led by God to their new home. It's an incredibly hopeful section of the Bible, which is probably why it's a very popular version, and you would if you look through it, you'll recognize a lot of the sections. I'm just going to read a couple of verses from right at the end of chapter 55 of Isaiah. For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. I think in our times that we've been living through, when our life has been disrupted, and many of us, you know, have been struggling with anxiety and fear. And even with the vaccine being rolled out, it's hard for us to see how life will ever be the same again. The landscape of our lives, of our culture, of even just the landscape of our high streets has changed. The way we do things has changed, you know, and we can't go back. We can only go forward. But what does that look like? And so I think today's theme of joy, with that sense of the word, it's not a word perhaps we use much, but it's a word filled with that sense of exuberance and liberation and life. It feels very attractive for us in these times, I think. But we're left with this question in this kind of exile that we're in at the moment, of how can we experience hope, love, peace, and joy. In the Bible, joy is not an abstract emotion. It's a response to God, and especially it's a response to God's saving acts. But it's also very much linked to the idea that God is with us. Psalm 16, verse 11 says, "In your presence there is fullness of joy." In your presence there is fullness of joy. And if you go back a few chapters in Isaiah to chapter 43, there are these reassuring words where God says, "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Saviour." I don't know, do you find that helpful? Is it just a kind of a comforting platitude? Just something to kind of calm a child in the middle of the night or something? You know, I'm drowning, I'm on fire. Where is God? How can I know God will be with me? Like joy in the Bible, the idea of the presence of God is not some abstract thing either. A few verses later in that chapter 43, God says, "I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished, quenched like a wick." For ancient Israel, faith in God was more like faithfulness, and that was primarily to do with God's faithfulness. They had a strong sense of being part of a story of who they were as a covenant community, and the sense of who God was in that story. And so the exiles could reassure themselves that God was with them, because God had many generations earlier led them out of slavery in Egypt and parted the sea before them so that they could escape from the pursuing Egyptian army. That's who God is, and that's what God does. This idea of the presence of God, that God will be with us, is not some talisman to take all danger and suffering from our lives. In the waters, in the fire, I will be with you. And when I feel despair and when I'm worrying about all sorts of things, it can be helpful to look back and remind myself of times when I've experienced God's presence, when my prayers have been answered, when God has unexpectedly provided for me. Those kinds of remembrances of God's goodness are helpful, but it's not a guarantee that I won't experience any suffering or darkness now. And knowing that God had liberated their ancestors from slavery and saved them through the parting of the Red Sea didn't stop the destruction of Jerusalem and its inhabitants going into exile. But perhaps it was a pointer to the big picture of a big God working on the big task of bringing peace and justice and life in its fullness to all creation, and to find rest, contentment, and even joy in that big story, choosing to own this as my story, as our story. I think there's a danger for us in our postmodern culture that we give up a sense of being part of a big story. You know, we don't believe in big stories. We don't even believe in history very much these days. Culturally, it seems we're adrift in a sea of relativism. And swept along in this culture, my sense of identity stops being rooted in the story of my community, but becomes tied up in my individual consumer choices. And that's about all, apart from how many people like my consumer choices. And perhaps it's no wonder that I'm prone to anxiety. I need God. Not just as an abstract concept, but as a concrete reality. God who relates to me, who is faithful to me, and to the community of faith to which I belong, past, present, and yet to come. Yet to come. Less mention of the Exodus and the parting of the Red Sea makes the exiles nostalgic. Isaiah moves on in chapter 43. To say, "Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old." I don't think he's saying don't do the history, don't just ignore what I've just said, because Isaiah does appeal to the history as we've just seen and the story of Israel and their memory of who they are. But they're not going back. God says, "I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." God is saying there's no going back to the good old days, because God is always on the move. So keep moving forward with God, who is with you, because God is doing something new. Isaiah and the other writing prophets in the Bible put into words a vision of how God wants the world to be. Their aim was to inspire people to put that vision into practice so that the words would become flesh. Isaiah's prophecy was only partly fulfilled by the return of the exiles, and so interpretation of it increasingly focused on a Messiah in whom it would be fulfilled. And when he came, Jesus was inspired by these visions of what the world would be like, the way that God wanted the world to be. And he talked about the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. Jesus chose for the prophecy to be fulfilled in him, but pointed ahead as well to its final fulfillment through him when that kingdom of heaven comes to earth. I've been reading over the past few months, really working my way through Matthew's gospel, and it struck me again how often Jesus tells stories or talks about the future and talks about what will happen, what the kingdom of God will look like when it comes. He talks about it quite often. And anyways, Jesus was an end times preacher. Perhaps wouldn't be very popular today. Oops. But we have this sense that the presence of God is not just something in the present. We have this history, we have this story that has already happened, but the story is not over yet. And the presence of God is promised. At the end of Matthew's gospel, Jesus said, when he says to his disciples to go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, he says, I will be with you always to the end of the age. God's presence is something promised into the future as well. And I think it's the same with joy. It's something we may have known, it's something we can know now, but it's something also that we look forward to. And the looking forward and the expectancy of that joy gives us joy now, I think. Psalm 30, verse 5 says, weeping lasts for the night, but joy comes in the morning. And back in Isaiah 55, it says, for you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. And it's something that's coming, something that is coming. So what can give us joy today is our hope of joy to come. And I think for Jesus, that sense of expectancy and what was ahead of him kept him going as he passed through the waters and the fires. I want to just a couple of verses from Hebrews 12, which my Bible goes over a page rather irritatingly. But the author says, let us look to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus knew what God wanted the world to be like. He knew from experience what the Holy Spirit could do in a person, that nothing would be impossible. He looked ahead to what his death and resurrection would achieve in a world where all things are made new. He looked ahead and he saw you, and he saw what you could become. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Now, it's a bit crass and crummy, bit of textual manipulation. I'm slightly ashamed to do this. But what if your name isn't Joy? Huh? Yeah, it's all very well saying for the joy set before him. What about for the Alex set before him, for the Dan set before him, Jesus, for the Sam set before him, for the Barbara set before him, for the you set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and has sat down at the right hand of God. When I have the privilege of baptizing people, I get, you know, they're in the water, or as long as you know, hope no Baptists are listening, but when I'm holding the child in my arms, I take them and I say to them, and I get these words from Church of Scotland before you think this is my idea, but say, God loves you, whoever you are. God loves you. For you, the Lord Jesus was born of Mary and lived our common life on earth. For you, he showed God's love in what he did and what he said. For you, he suffered the darkness of the cross and died for you. For you, he was raised to life on the third day and ascended to the right hand of the Father. And he is coming back for you. All this he does for you because he loves you. And if you'd been the only person ever to need a saviour, he would have done it for you. He loves you so much. And then into the waters they go and out to new life. And I think this is where we find joy, isn't it? It's all very odd saying the presence of God or the history. God loves you. That's the heart of it. That's the depth of it. That's the height of it, is the love of God. God loves you, and you know God loves you because you've experienced God's action in your life. And in the church, we're part of a community that has experienced God's loving and saving action over thousands of years. And much more than that, you know God loves you because Jesus came and died and rose again for you. But the story isn't over. Your story isn't over. Jesus' story isn't over. The world's story isn't over. Jesus is risen, and he's the firstborn of a new creation. And if he's the first, then we have hope that God will in time make all things new. God is leading us home to a Jesus-shaped world, to a new creation, to the kingdom of heaven on earth, to a world healed and made new. And I think the invitation of Advent is to find hope and joy in this big story that is not yet finished. To rest in the assurance that what God has started in Jesus, God will finish. To let these prophecies of the world becoming the way God wants it to be shape how we live today, so that we in turn shape that vision becoming reality. To make our celebration of the coming of Jesus at Christmas just a foreshadowing of the big celebrations there'll be when the kingdom of heaven comes to earth and there's no more pain, no more fear, no more death, when God is with us and wipes every tear from our eyes, when we will go out in joy and be led back in peace, and the mountains and hills burst into song and the trees of the field clap their hands. God, who was, who is, and who is to come, God is with us. And one day we will be in the fullness of the presence of God. And in God's presence, there is fullness of joy. I've got a song for us to sing now. Just have a sip of water. Actually, I won't have a sip of water. So this is a song, if you've been to Greenbelt, you might recognise this one. And it looks ahead to that one day, and you might like to make up your own words to this later on in the day, who knows. So the chorus is very simple, and then I sing some verses, and we sing the chorus, and we work our way through the days of the week. I'm just not sure what version we've got up there, but the chorus goes like this, very easy. One day, perhaps it will be Sunday. One day we will live in peace and the little child will lead us. Okay, so that's it. So I've done a few services in other churches during this time, and I'd say, let's not stand up and not sing the next song. But you at home, you can join in to your heart's content. I hope you will. One day, perhaps it will be someday. One day we will live in peace and a little child will lead us. One day brown envelopes will land on welcome mats because they will always be good news or an invitation to a party. One day pips will be for growing apple trees and hoops will be for hula hooping and not jumping through. One day loan sharks will climb sycamore trees and pay their clients all their money back with interest. One day someone will turn out the light in the last food bank because everyone will have enough to eat and we will all shout, hooray! One day, perhaps it will be Saturday. One day we will live in peace and a little child will lead us. One day mutual aid groups will just be the way society is because we really will be all in it together whatever the latest it may be. One day every penny and every pound will be invested in peace and justice, not in profit. One day the earth will stop revolving around the rich and will joyfully loop the loop, encircling life for all. One day shops will only be sweaty because the sun's shining a bit too much, and all trade will be fair trade. One day, perhaps it will be Friday. One day we will live in peace and a little child will lead us. One day burqas and turbans, skull caps and tweed caps will be unremarkable unless they are a particularly bright shade of fuchsia. One day the hostile environment will be history, with shaking fists becoming shaken hands. One day I will become we, you will become us, and family will be about love and laughter and not just blood. One day it will only matter that we love and are loved, not who we love. One day, perhaps it will be Thursday. One day we will live in peace and a little child will lead us. One day we will all believe that the bicycle is preferable to the internal combustion engine, but sometimes we'll go by bus, which will be electric. One day there will be world championships in darning and everyone will know how to make a patch and sew on a button. One day both those who don't have enough and those who have far too much will be liberated by having just what they need. One day shoppers will calculate the cost to the earth as well as the cost to their purse. One day, perhaps it will be Wednesday. One day we will live in peace and a little child will lead us. One day the only people sleeping rough will be stargazers, because everyone will have a place to call home. One day trolls will only be found in fairy tales and people will be kind to each other face to face and online. One day politicians will listen before they speak, and the wisdom of children will be universally prized. One day I will love and pray and vote for you and you and you and you and only finally for me. One day, perhaps it will be Tuesday. One day they will live in peace and a little child will lead us. One day wolves will live in the same field as little lambs, and the wolves will look after the lambs, and the lambs will teach the wolves how to sing. One day the only buzzing in the forest will be the happy thrum of insects, and the only chopping sound come from woodpeckers. One day the elm and the ash and all the trees will clap their hands, and the mountains and the hills sing for joy. One day Jesus will look out over a new creation where every living creature is flourishing together in peace, and a broad smile will spread across his face, and he will laugh from the depths of his belly and never stop laughing forever and ever, world without end, amen. One day, perhaps it will be Monday. One day we will live in peace and a little child will lead us. One day, perhaps it will be Sunday, Saturday, Friday, Thursday, Wednesday, Tuesday, Monday. One day we will live in peace and a little child will lead us.
Deep in my heart, I was really hoping that there would be an Alex Mabbs song, and I've been well rewarded. I was living in joyful expectation of that moment, and it came. Thank you, Alex. That was really awesome. The bit that just kind of kept coming to my mind from the story of the Nativity was when the shepherds are out. And it says, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified, but the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." And this whole thing of a baby coming into the world, being good news of great joy, not just like Alex just said, not just for a few of us, but for everyone. I just love that image as well of Jesus laughing for joy. Jesus, just from his belly, just laughing and laughing and laughing. And that joy encompassing the whole world. In a moment, we'll close together by saying the grace. But just a few notices before we do that. Firstly, there won't be a Be Still and Know this evening. So apologies if you're planning to come to that. Don't come here this evening. But next Sunday, you will be richly rewarded because we're going to have two carol services. One in the morning, which will be our kind of family-friendly, all-agey kind of carol service with Sarah Walker at the helm. And that will be really, really great and a lot of fun. And I think that will just be live streaming, so don't come into the room for that, but definitely do watch it. That'll be at 10:30 online. Next Sunday evening then will be our a more kind of traditional carol service, and we'll put up a couple of like tasters of what to expect from that. We're really excited as we think and plan towards that service. On Christmas morning then, we will have a pre-recorded service together that we're going to be working on this week, and that hopefully will just be a really fun way to sit down at some point on your Christmas day, make some time as a family. You could do it at the normal time of, I think 10 a.m. is like the normal Christmas service time. So you could do it then and be traditional and proper. But equally, at any point in the day, you could take some time out and watch that as a family or as your household or as just by yourself or whatever, and take some time out and kind of engage with the story together. And so that will be really great too. So lots to engage with over the next couple of weeks. Keep tuning in to the Advent stuff that Kath is posting. And most importantly, I guess, in this time, let's be sharers of joy together. Let's get in touch with each other. Write cards to each other. Like, let people know, hey, I'm thinking of you through this season. And let's not let this season kind of draw us into introversion, but push us out towards each other and towards sharing this joy, sharing this love, sharing this peace, sharing this hope with each other. So let's say the grace together. So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. See you soon.